What do you want?
I'm looking for the professor.
There's no professor here.
And who are you?
Hank McCoy.
Ah, you must be Beast.
Don't know what you're talking about.
You're quite strong for a scrawny kid.
Don't try me.
Come on, isn't there even a hint of Beast in there?
Really, don't try me.
Hey, look, kid. You and I are going to be great friends. You just don't know it yet. Right. That's it. Hank. What have I told you about fighting in the house? Jesus fucking Christ. I'm out of fucking drink. Fuck. Hello, ladies and gentlemen, Nick here, and welcome to my review of X-Men, Days of Future Past. Finally, after about a week or so since the Doctor Sleep review said that this would be the next review, and about 3 weeks since the Wolverine review on the Retro Channel, which saying this would be the next review. I saw this film in cinemas in 2014, and as I'm doing cinema films pre-2015 on this channel, as special reviews as well, I may as well do it here. So, X-Men Days of Future Past. The plot of this film sees, well, we're basically about 10 years into the future after the events of the Wolverine, or maybe it's 8 years actually, as the end, the post-credits scene was about 2 years after the rest of the film. But it's 2023, and there's been this war between Sentinels and mutants, leaving only the worst of humanity in charge, as the Sentinels would pick out the genetics in mutants who were going to have mutant children, humans, who were going to have mutant children or grandchildren, as well as the humans who dared to help the mutants, because of morals, probably. And like I said, the worst of humanity is left in charge. And most of the mutants are dead. There's only a handful left. And after a great sequence where we show a couple of mutants escaping from the Sentinels by Shadowcat, played by Ellen Page, who we last saw in The Last Stand, having the consciousness of new mutants, Bishop travel back in time to warn their younger selves about the attack, then they can escape the place before the Sentinels even come. Charles Xavier, played by Patrick Stewart, who is not dead after the events of The Last Stand, that was pretty much established at the end of The Wolverine, and similarly, Ian McKellen's Magneto has got his powers back, and which was sort of hinted at the end of The Last Stand, along with Charles surviving. And then the end of the Wolverine confirms this, and now here we are. So they come up with the idea of using Shadowcat to send the Professor's consciousness back in time to his younger body so that they can prevent Mystique, played by Jennifer Lawrence, from assassinating Dr. Bolivar Trask, played by Peter Dinklage, and therefore having been captured and used in the Trask Industries experiments that would go on to create the Sentinels in under 50 years. However, the Shadowcat can't project the Professor's mind back more than a few months, otherwise he would die. So they send Wolverine in as he can regenerate his mind with his healing powers. So Wolverine, played by Hugh Jackman once again, in another fantastic performance, by the way. They all do some amazing performances in this film. Even the lesser known cast for the mutants that aren't there that long, they do some great jobs. Anyway, Wolverine is sent back to his 1973 body, and he goes to find the younger Professor, played by James McAvoy from First Class, and also Hank McCoy, aka Beast, played by Nicholas Hoult. And eventually, after managing to convince the Professor, because he's now taking this serum too that helps him walk, but it suppresses his mind power, his mental powers, and he's in this depressed state after the Vietnamese War started up, where so lots of the students and staff had to conscribe, or at least the male ones. I'm not sure about the female ones. What happened? Unless the female ones secretly joined the Vietnamese War as well. I wasn't aware of that. Modern warfare, probably, but Vietnamese War would be a bit surprised. Maybe the occasional secretary or maybe an up-and-coming general. This isn't sexism, by the way. This is historical understanding. Speaking of which, Mystique actually goes out to rescue some of the mutants out in Saigon and send the troops home, and then heads off to meet with some Vietnamese guides so she can knock him out and take his place at the meeting in Paris. Charles and Hank agree to help Wolverine, and they have to break Eric Magneto out, as he is trapped underneath the Pentagon, as he supposedly killed President Kennedy. That is one of the things I wasn't so keen on about this film, is that Magneto was President Kennedy's assassin, and then turned out that he was trying to save him because Kennedy was a mutant. Yeah, it didn't really work out that great for me. It didn't really work. I mean, nice idea, but it's a good idea on paper, but I think in execution it doesn't quite work as that as well. Maybe if it was another assassination of an important guy, or maybe if he was implied to be involved, but not the actual assassin or supposed assassin, maybe it would make sense. Anyway, so they get help from Evan Peters, Peter Maximoff, different one from the MCU, and that one dies anyway. This one gets to appear in three movies, although his best stuff is probably in this one. Although he can get most to do in Apocalypse, and pretty much wasted in the last film, Dark Phoenix. We get some really great scenes with him, and they eventually break Eric, played by Michael Fassbender, out, and then they head off to Paris, apart from Quicksilver, who goes home. Why did they didn't take him with him? I'm not sure. Maybe it means that the movie would be over too quick. But still, they go to Paris and they prevent Mystique from killing Trask, after she's discovered stuff about him experimenting on mutants, and they also stop Stryker from capturing her. However, Eric decides that in order to secure their future, he has to kill her. So obviously they do that. Meanwhile, Wolverine has a moment after seeing Colonel William Stryker and remembers X2. And by the way, there's a couple of flashback scenes to X's 2 and 3. Apparently one, and as well as Origins and First Class also, well, First Class does have a few flashbacks as well, but one and Origins Wolverine apparently have some. And the Wolverine, not sure. Or maybe they were going to be used at least, and they just got the copyright credits in the credits. Anyway, so Wolverine has a moment, but he eventually comes around. And at that point, Mystique escapes from Eric, despite him attempting to kill her, thanks to Hank pretty much interfering. And the world sees the mutants as they are, and the president goes ahead with using the Sentinel, displaying the Sentinel program. A piece of Mystique's blood is used in the experiments analysed by Trask, and they're going to use those for the experiments. And then everyone just pretty much goes back to square one and tries to figure out what to do. After a brief moment, well, I say brief, a couple minutes of self-doubt, Charles eventually talks with his older self, and they have a conversation, which pretty much motivates the younger Charles to get back into the game and start helping. And eventually he, Hank and Wolverine head to DC to the president's meeting so they can stop Mystique from killing Trask. Meanwhile, Eric prepares to pretty much show the world about their powers. I suppose in a way to prevent mutant extinction in the future, but he's going about it the wrong way, as it's going to be more determined to have the humans go against the mutants with what he does. Which is why they're trying to stop Mystique from killing Trask. Eventually, Eric lands a stadium in the middle of around the White House, and how he's gotten metal railway rails into the Sentinels so that they would obey his commands, and tries to assassinate the president and cabinet, including Trask. However, Mystique stops him, and then attempts on Trask, but Charles manages to convince her otherwise. And at the same time, we're seeing the final battle between the mutants in the future against the Sentinels, their final stand. And it's actually really great seeing a old Magneto, after being wounded and dying on the floor, He's talking to Charles about all the years of fighting each other, and he's reflecting on what's happened whilst we see the younger Magneto doing some bad stuff. That's actually really cool, and it's also really great how we're seeing this battle of the future playing out at the same time we're seeing the battle in the past. And when Mystique makes her choice, it's the building up to that. It's really great showing the build up from both time angles. It's so well done. This is a brilliantly made. Eventually, she decides not to kill Trask, and Magneto becomes a fugitive. But mutants aren't as feared as much. In fact, in a deleted scene, there's even a bit where the president suggests that they should get some mutants on their side, which is always a good thing. And Trask is taken into custody for selling military secrets. As we did see earlier, he was convincing the North Vietnamese. And that deleted scene sort of reveals that, with Stryker saying that Trask was selling secrets off to Russia, China, and the North Vietnamese. Though, to be fair, if you're in Trask's shoes, and I can imagine him using this argument, he would sell his information and weapons and everything to everybody so that they could fight the mutants. He would sell them to the Americans, the Russians, anyone who would want to defend themselves from the mutants. I can imagine that being his argument. Of course, being the Americans, they wouldn't give a shit and just think he's a traitor or something, because America. Actually, scratch that. Patriotism. Doesn't matter which country. Patriotism. So anyway, at the end, Wolverine wakes up in the future. Everything's changed. Everything's actually quite nice. Even the events of the first three of the original trilogy, first three films of the original trilogy, Origins Wolverine, As It Happened, and The Wolverine, they've been changed. Their history's been changed. Things haven't happened their way, which isn't too much of a problem in terms of, in some cases, but at the same time, there were some good stories. Well, not all of them, but some of them. Most of them. And then we see Wolverine at the very end being rescued, presumably by Mystique disguised as Stryker. An alternative ending has it as the real Stryker. But in this ending, we have the eyes going, so we presume it's Mystique. Of course, that's also in Apocalypse, that Wolverine was taken to Alkali Lake, which leads him on his journey into the future. So that ends the best movie in the X-Men series. My God, this one's a perfect film. I'm glad Bryan Singer, director of the first two installments, came back to helm this one. And I'm glad that Simon Kinberg, writer and producer of most, if not all, of the original trilogy, and the writers of First Class, Jane Goldman and Matthew Vaughan, they wrote the story. Just check that. Yeah, Jane Goldman, Simon Kinberg and Matthew Vaughan that was their story, with Simon Kinberg writing the screenplay. Yeah, he kind of goes up and down when it comes, like Neil Purvis and Robert Wade with the Bond films. Simon Kinberg's writing on the X-Men films does go up and down depending on the installment. Some stories are great and some are not. No, he doesn't write all of them, but some of them are great and some of them are not. On the ones he does do. And yeah, I think they've crafted a masterful film with a star cast, both the main players and the supporting characters. Wolverine, Hugh Jackman, probably his best performance pre-Logan. James McAvoy, probably his best performance of the X-Men films. Same for Michael Fassbender and Nicholas Holt, and definitely for Jennifer Lawrence, for the younger characters. Younger Professor X, younger Magneto, younger Beast, and younger Mystique. Patrick Stewart, Ian McKellen, they do great jobs once again in their roles. I think this is probably McKellen's best performance, this or in X2. Patrick Stewart would probably do one better in Logan, like with Jackman, but still do amazing performances here. And also notable, Ellen Page does a great job as Shadowcat. Sean Ashmore and Daniel, can't remember his surname, they return as Iceman and Colossus. And also Anna Paquin gets a cameo as Rogue. Apparently there's actually a Rogue cut, which you can get on Blu-ray, where there's some additional scenes with Rogue helping out with the transferring Wolverine back in time. Not sure how that works, I haven't seen that version. Not even sure how she got there, because she isn't there in the other scenes. It might have been just better if she was just there full stop, and not just making a cameo in the new timeline scenes. Though it does show that she is back together with Bobby. And also with that, it may, like with Magneto's powers, maybe the cure stopped working for her and maybe the other mutants as well. Maybe it stopped working. Possibly. Or maybe they were too strong. Or maybe it's following the Last Stand alternative ending for her character continuity. I mean, going by these movies' continuity record, I wouldn't put it past it. And that's been about, and Halle Berry's also back as Storm. She does great. Similarly, Famke Janssen and James Marsden and Kelsey Grammer also return as Jean Grey, Scott Summers / Cyclops, and the older Hank McCoy / Beast in cameos at the very end as well. And also we've got probably my favourite William Stryker after Brian Cox in with the younger one. I can't remember his actor's name, but it's the new Stryker is probably my favourite of the ones after Brian Cox. I think Cox just brought such a great role to the character. And I like how, I think Trask has influenced Stryker, as some of the things Trask does and says sort of influences Stryker in X2. And there is a lot of X1 and X2, and maybe even a couple of X3 similarities in this film, which I actually like. I think it's pretty good. Although continuity references to First Class, some of them are a little different, such as Professor X saying Wolverine to F off. He says, we're going to tell you what you said to us all those years ago. Actually in First Class, Wolverine said, go F yourself. And I think there's a couple of continuity references when it comes to continuity from First Class that's actually a little bit wrong, such as the whole fact about, Eric took Raven away. Raven followed a darker path. You do realise, Charles, that you told her to go with Eric in the first place. So whilst she fell in love with him during the course of the First Class film, you did tell her to go with him instead of begging her to stay. I did make some suggestions of, wow, that scene could have gone down instead in the review. So I think they could have reworded some of these lines here to actually reference what actually did happen in First Class. They actually referenced the first three films better than they referenced First Class, which is a more recent film. Minor gripes aside, the story is amazing and it's well plotted, really well done. Characters are great. Some stunning visual effects, especially with Blink's portal scenes when she's transferring the other mutants and Sentinels away into different spots. It looks so cool. And yeah, just some amazing stuff here. And even some cool use of, I think it's Super 8 film reel, although there is some weird shots of just people thrown in there. But you know, I won't complain too much. It's probably just showing what's going on, even if there's something else happening at the same time. But it's still some good stuff. There's plenty to enjoy in this movie, and it's not too long either. It's about 2 hours and 5 to 10 minutes. So it's not too long. It's actually perfectly paced, well-timed. There could have been a few more scenes that were cut that could have been re-included, but I think it's still handled really well. And I think the character development also handled greatly, and it's perfectly done. On the whole, X-Men Days of Future Past is probably where the X-Men franchise peaks. I'm sorry, X-Men 2 and Logan fans, but I think the X-Men series peaked at Days of Future Past by putting in the best effort to cross over the First Class and original trilogy timelines and just merge them together, as well as maybe also start up a new timeline that may try and iron out some of the more disappointing entries into the series, though doesn't completely succeed with that, as there is some entries later down the line that some would consider just as, if not even more disappointing, depends who you ask. But I think most of us can agree that Days of Future Past is definitely one of the strongest entries, and for me it's my personal favourite. So I'm going to be giving X-Men Days of Future Past a 10 out of 10. Apart from a few minor problems, such as the continuity referencing from First Class and a couple of other bits, such as Eric being supposedly responsible for the president's, President Kennedy's assassination, and him actually turning out to be a mutant. So apart from a few minor problems, pretty perfect, pretty well done. And yeah, definitely my favourites entering the X-Men series. I do love Logan. I do love Deadpool. I do love X2. I do love First Class. I do love the Wolverine. And also really like the first film and Deadpool 2. And I even liked The Last Stand. And I did kind of like Apocalypse and Dark Phoenix. Though they might go down on the rewatches, especially Dark Phoenix, which I've only seen once at time recording. That will probably go down. The only one that's currently doesn't really work for me is Origins Wolverine, and that, even then, that took a couple of viewings to get as low down as it did. But Days of Future Past, I think he's always going to impress me, and just, yeah, what an amazing film. Anyway, that's it from me. Thank you for watching. The next film in the X-Men series, technically, is Deadpool, which I've already reviewed, but I might re-review this. Maybe, if not, then X-Men Apocalypse will be the next X-Men review, because I'm definitely re-reviewing that. Probably also review Dark Phoenix. And even if I don't re-review the Deadpool films or Logan, I'm still going to re-watch them anyway, because I'm watching them in the order, in their filmy orders. And if you're watching the reviews in order and I don't re-review the next films besides maybe Apocalypse and Dark Phoenix, which I probably will do, but for the other ones, if I don't re-review those, then they're coming up in the playlist, on the Retro Channel playlist. As for further films on this channel, well, I will be reviewing Frozen. I was hoping to do it before Frozen 2 came out. I am hoping to see Frozen 2 at this weekend, but no promises. So I'll be reviewing Frozen hopefully by the end of the month. And hopefully Frozen 2 as well before the end of the month. So fingers crossed for both of those. I'm not going to go say like X-Men Days of Future Past is the next review after Doctor Strange. I'm not going to confirm it because I'm not 100% certain whether Frozen or Frozen 2 or something else will be the next review on this channel. Same for the Retro Channel. I'm not sure what's going to be coming up on that one apart from some rankings. And yes, I will do an X-Men ranking after I've rewatched the other films after Days of Future Past. Anyway, that's it from me. Thank you for watching. I'll see you guys next time whenever and whatever that will be. Goodbye. Don't forget to click below to subscribe to the official Nicholas Payne YouTube channel. And then it pretty much saw. This isn't sexism. This is the fact that This isn't sexism, bud. Anyway. Eventually, a fight ensues. Eventually, Mystique attempts assassination on Trask. So we've got, which actually isn't too much of a Quarian. Along with a story by First Class writers, with original trilogy writers Simon, and producer Simon Kinberg, Jane Goldman and Matthew Vaughan, and what's his name, James. Lots of great stuff. On the whole, X-Men Days of Future Past is because why not? So anyway, that's it from. However, I don't know if that's going to happen. So, unless I see Frozen 2 after, I was hoping to see it at. And who you? You're quite scoring. Look, I'm here to see the professor, so move it.
No.
Come on, it's Hanoi. Look, kid. Hank McCoy. Don't know what you're talking about. Prick.